Previously on DDFP.
Rhoda, please come here for a minute. I want to ask you something real quick. Rake everybody 1 through 4 in terms of handsomeness.
You put Rhoda on blast just a minute ago. Like, that's what we're talking about.
Right. He's a bad puss.
Some people like bad guys.
I like the Joker. Joker's one of my favorite characters.
How long has it been since this many teams were undefeated after week 5?
1941.
Oh, good, good. See,
Ian just likes making up stuff.
I've said that Andy Dalton will never win a Super Bowl. Is that fair, MJD?
I'm an Andy Dalton fan.
Man, Andy Dalton made me a believer yesterday.
Hi and hello, football fans. It's your old pal Dave. Dave Dameshek. What's going down? I hope all's well wherever you are. Welcome to the Dave Dameshek football program, available on iTunes, Stitcher, NFL.com, YouTube, so on and so forth. And as always, presented by McDonald's. All day breakfast, every day. What's not to love about that? I'll tell you what I'm loving. Well, I'll tell you some other things that I'm really loving, but I love in general that week 6 of NFL is here. As you can see, if you're watching us rather than listening to us, seated to the far left over there, you watch him on NFL Network, chopping up all the news. It's Patrick Claybon. What's the poop with you, fella?
Just love being here. Love being here, and I love it.
I'm so excited about that. And then also, all the way from London, England, he is our resident Miami Dolphins fan. It's Handsome Hank. He's handsome. Hello, handsome. How are you?
I am very well indeed. Thank you, Dave.
I bet you are. You know what? My heart is full. It's been empty, but it is filled once again because in Studio 66, or at least on the monitor behind me, we will be talking in a matter of moments with one-time Lombardi winner, two-time Shecky Award winner for our favorite football playing guest, A.J. Hawk of the undefeated Cincinnati Bengals. It is a banner day. Rejoice, a national holiday, I declare, for the Shek Republic. I can't wait to catch up with Hawk. Also coming up, of course, Claybon filling in for the usual Elliot Harrison here. We're going to do the Red Challenge Flag pick segment. This is when you two go head-to-head in trying to divine who's going to win the biggest games in the NFL. In week 6, we have a new worst plays in NFL history. This is a hot bit that people really seem to be enjoying quite a bit, so stick around for that. And of course, football baby, speaking of red hot, he continues to roll. He is now 12-3 on the season. I think that makes him, what, 43-14?
Yes.
44-14, something like that.
Certain math.
I'll check the math on that. I don't know why we're not rejoicing about this more as a nation, as a world, that a one-year-old baby is this keen at picking football games. But either way, stick around. If you want to make all the right picks for your games, you're going to want to see football baby's picks. All right, let's get to it then. Where are they? Not the worst place. No. What are we doing right now? We're doing I want you to interact with us. That's what I wanted to mention to you before anything else. I'm looking at my notes here. Yes, hashtag at DDFP so you can join in on the conversation. That's what I wanted to say. And I will say, some listeners have been joining the conversation of late. And listen, I don't mind the critiques. I welcome the critiques. Some people have mentioned that from an audio standpoint, they feel like some of the visual stuff we're doing isn't translating. We are working on it. Black tie behind the glass, Emma VP, Will, and the goth kid Gothard all doing gangbusters work with video, really making the show look great. If you haven't checked it out on YouTube or NFL.com, I encourage you, Nate, demand that you do so. If you are a consumer strictly for audio, we are trying to work those kinks out. We appreciate you sticking with us. We're already evolving a little bit. We're a little bit better than we were a week ago and the week before that, but we are an imperfect machine.
I'll also say this though, Shek. If you're listening to the audio, check out the video too. Some great stuff.
I just said
some really, really good stuff on there.
So. I agree. Emma VP in particular has done some great stuff. So I added a few things that really jazz up the visuals. So hopefully you'll get a chance to look at that stuff. But I understand some people prefer to consume it via the audio. We are not going away from that. We're not ditching doing that, or we're not. That's not secondary to us. We're just trying to work it out.
Yeah. All I'm saying is this
sounds like the worst Bill Belichick press conference.
But just for Hank's open alone, it's worth it.
Right. I mean, and let's be honest, that is actually where a lot of the money has been spent this year. Like we put a budget of $300,000 or $400,000 together to produce that open. So if you're not looking at it on YouTube, you're kind of missing out on the whole point of the
Idris
show.
Elba, who? Handsome right. Hank right. for the next James Bond.
These Still Not to Come graphics, which is like your regular TV. You see the coming up and Still to Come. Emma VP does a spoof of Still Not to Come, so you got to check out.
They're great. They really are.
They're very good. All right, so let's get into it. Week 6 of the NFL. AJ Hawk coming up in a matter of moments. Right now, we're presented by McDonald's, so let's talk about who we're loving as we go into the week. Who are you loving? And you know what, Handsome, you're more of a regular. Let's start with our visitor.
Okay, that's Claybon. Fine with me.
I'm loving Todd Gurley. How can you not love Todd Gurley? The Rams are on the bye week, and so this is a guy, a fellow ACL-ian, as you know, we're all.
You're an ACL guy.
I'm an ACL. Yep.
Really?
Yep.
Todd Gurley, all.
I don't move fast enough to hurt my. That's always the silver lining of being sluggish.
And so I'm loving the Todd, who has really changed the complexion of the Rams. Gets a chance to have a week off because people will see him running at 21.9 miles an hour and assume that he's 100%. He's not, and it's going to be a while before he's actually 100%. And so for him to get a chance to have a week where the swelling can go down and he can focus on him, I think it's a good thing.
That's a scary thought that he's going to get better. Because he was,
Look out NFC West. I will critique you since we're in the critiquing mode right now. You love a guy on his bye. That's really not a very great. Is that a great way to get excited for week 6?
I love that he has
his bye. Hey, he's sitting on a couch this weekend. How awesome. Listen, I do hear you. And I do think a couple things. First of all, when he's in L.A. Ram, it's going to be exciting to be watching him. That's a great piece to get excited about, Los Angeles. One. Two, if the Rams had just beaten D.C., which is, big if, but had they done that, if they were sitting there right now at 3-2, there'd be a lot of noise being made. And I don't think they're out of playoff contention. And in fact, we talked about that with Rosenthal and Hanzus on the last episode. Go back and dig that one up. Gangbuster stuff, chopping up the undefeated power teams and the Arizona Cardinals and how they fit into that whole mix. Handsome, how say you? Who are you loving?
David, here's what I'm loving, okay? I don't know if you've heard, but this week, the Seattle Seahawks will be hosting the Carolina Panthers.
I have heard.
The same thing happened last year. Last year in week 7, so a week later than this, the Panthers and Seahawks played each other. And everyone was criticizing the Seahawks and saying, obviously coming off the Super Bowl win that time and saying, I don't know if they're going to get it done. They don't seem to be the team that they were. They went in, beat the Panthers, won, I think, 11 of their next 12 games. Obviously went to the Super Bowl, and then we all know what happened after that. I picked the Seahawks as my Super Bowl team. From the NFC this year. So maybe there's a little bit of hope in this. But I think that what you're going to see is a Panthers team that's undefeated going to Seattle, get smoked by the Seahawks, because I think they are starting to put it together a little bit on offense. We talked about it in the last podcast that maybe their defense has been better than everyone thinks that it's been, but the offense is really struggling still to click. I think it's going to happen for them this week, and it's going to be the start of a roll that goes through at least to the playoffs.
Well, the Panthers' defense is very, very, very good, and people seem somehow that's one of those defenses. And there are a lot of defenses emerging. We keep talking about Denver, and it'll be interesting to see the Jets come back after a bye. We've forgotten about them a little bit, but that Carolina defense is for real too. So this could be one of those 3-2 kind of final.
And they get Kuechly back.
Yep, and Marshawn Lynch on the other side of things, and number one. My dark horse MVP candidate to this point in the season, while everybody's getting distracted by Tom Brady and Aaron Rodgers, Cam Newton carrying that offense single-handedly. What do I love? I love the month of October. It is I mean, really, this is where it's at. If you are a sports fan, pro football now, we have a sense of who these pro teams are. College football now fully into conference play. That's when it starts really getting good. The weather with the, well, you know, we're not here in Los Angeles, but
like most 95 degrees.
Yeah, I know. But most of the country, the weather's getting crisp and the leaves are turning glorious colors. And you go out and you tailgate before the game. There's nothing more fun than that. Baseball playoffs. And you know what, by the way, the only thing I don't love about baseball, aside from my Pirates already being eliminated, is this bat flip nonsense. Can we stop about the bat flip? I mean, you're hurting your own sport here, baseball, when you keep talking about, I respect the sport. You're allowed to be, just know this, curmudgeon. If you don't like the bat flip, you're more conservative than Bill Belichick is on the subject. Because Belichick says, hey, it's hard to score in pro sports. But you should be happy, and you're allowed to show it a little bit.
The thing I like about the curmudgeons, though, if not for them, the bat flip discussion wouldn't be as fun. Like, I wouldn't have appreciated
it. You need to have the haters to.
Because when, you know, Batista gives that extra little flip, I felt like that was him.
Yeah, rare is the opportunity to call other people squares. And so it gives me that opportunity.
As a non-baseball fan, can I, like, the way that I try to understand this is it's really about the how hard you would be spiking a ball after a touchdown. Seems like the equivalent in the NFL. Right. Would be like, you can spike it quite hard, but if you spike it too hard, we're going to penalize you. So Gronk would be like a 15-yard penalty after every touchdown.
Three shakes is too much.
Right.
Yeah, and by the way, it's not, you know, the Dameshek's world isn't consumed entirely by sport. You know, I enjoy the game called life, and a big part of my life is television. The Nick is coming back.
I think it's already back.
Is it back? No, did I miss it? Yeah, it hasn't premiered yet. Sorry, the Leftovers is back. Last Man on Earth is back. There's much to be excited about right now. So, all right. So that's what I'm loving. And now I am very excited. Fellas, stick around. We're going to get to it right now. Let's get to our visit with our old pal, AJ Hawk. Well, if you've been listening to the DDFP for any amount of time, you know that my heart is full. It's been empty for too long, but he's back finally. He is the host of the great Hawkcast, a tremendous podcast that interviews everybody from philosophers to astronauts to me, which was probably the low point in the show. Also, HawksLocksForKids.org, go to that one. He is a one-time Lombardi Trophy winner. He is a two-time Shecky Award winner for our favorite football playing guest. It's AJ Hawk. Hawk, what's the poop, fella?
Not much. I tell you what, you might be the best ever at introing a guest, so I really appreciate it, Dameshek. It's good to be back.
Well, at least I have something going for me. However, I'm not 5-0 like you are. How's it going in Cincy these days?
It's been fun, honestly. I mean, 5-0, is obviously makes everything a little nicer, but I don't know. It's just been there's a great culture going on here. It's a new place for me. My first year here coming off 9 years in Green Bay, I didn't know what to expect coming in, but the guys have been just amazing from day one. You know, coming into this locker room, you can, I don't know, there was like an energy you could feel that guys are just, I don't know, it's really close and it's a lot of fun, honestly, it really is.
So nobody did like in Mean Girls and make you sit in a bathroom stall to eat your lunch the first week or two?
Not yet, they haven't at least, so hopefully I've gotten past that initial hazing phase, but hopefully, coming in as the old guy, gets a few of those little minor details out of the way. So they've been very welcoming since day one. So I really appreciate it.
So really, though, you say it's a nice thing. How weird was it, though, that for like the training camp or whatever else going in 9 years in Wisconsin and all that? Was it a strange transition or do people, what's that like? Because anybody else starts a new job, you have to go around and meet people. I think when we forget about that with football guys that, you still are a human being. And is it odd?
I mean, I would say, honestly, just the first day was kind of weird. It's like going to almost like a new school or something. You just don't really know the schedule. You don't know exactly where your meeting rooms may be. And you don't know everybody on the team, obviously. I've watched and seen a lot of them on film and played against a lot of these guys. But to actually be in here and a part of everything, it was odd, I'd say, the first couple of days just because you're trying to figure out where to go. You just follow the pack like you're a young kid and going to your first day of school. But after, honestly, the first couple of days, it felt like I'd been here forever. It just feels normal and it feels right. So it doesn't hurt that I'm an Ohio guy and I grew up about 45 minutes north of here.
Let's talk about this in the meantime. Andy Dalton has been dynamite so far this year. But what I've noticed about him is he has a different swagger, and I think that starts at the top there. You used to have the golden locks, and that copycat Clay Matthews makes all that hay. Now, oh, I have the long flowing locks. Hey, copycat, you stole it from Hawk. Now, Andy Dalton, the key figure of your new team, seems to have taken some hair lessons from you. Any truth to this?
No, I don't think so. I mean, Andy kind of had that little whatever style he has going on when I got here.
It's like a crew cut.
April 20th, yeah, with like a lot of, he's got a lot of good volume in there, you know, and obviously being a redhead, it stands out in the pack, you know, so it's one of those things that I think I give him a lot of credit for. I've seen him in the mirror putting whatever kind of paste or whatever kind of hair product he has on, and he looks good though, man, don't you think?
I think he looks vastly superior to what, I mean, it was like a, I don't know if it was like Jim Carrey and Dumb and Dumber kind of hair before, but now it's like, yeah, he's got a frohawk, not unlike you. I feel like you probably inspired it.
I can't take credit for that. I mean, but I think he definitely takes pride in it, and I respect him. I respect him for that.
Do you say anything to him? I don't know. You've been around the NFL long enough that certainly your word carries some weight, even in a new locker room. Do you go to Andy Dalton and say, listen, I know Aaron Rodgers personally and professionally. Here's what he does. Maybe try some of that. Do you legitimately have anything like, here's some tips that I learned from Rodgers?
No, because the one thing that I think anyone would agree is that unsolicited advice is pretty annoying and nobody wants any of that. I'm not going to go to him and tell him something without him asking me questions. I talked to Andy a lot, and from when I got here, I realized how good of a guy he was and how big of a competitor he is. So if he's asking me questions about guys I've played with or things that, you know, offenses do that are tough for defenders, I'll answer him and give him my opinion. But I do not give unsolicited advice to anybody.
I'll say that's where you and I part ways. I give advice to everybody. I don't wait for them to ask. I just tell them how it needs to be going forward. That's where we're
I respect that from you. Trust me. That's why we get along, because the yin and yang of our relationship.
I see. Yeah, I guess that makes sense. So Cincinnati chili or Wisconsin bratwurst?
Well, I grew up in Ohio, so Skyline chili is a staple here, even though I haven't had I'm kind of weird, man. I haven't had like red meat or chili in 7, 8, 9 years probably now.
I forgot about that, right? Yeah, you don't eat that.
I'm not a vegan or anything, and definitely not that, but yeah, I'm just straight chicken and fish, man, all day.
I don't care myself for the Skyline chili. I think that's one of the more overrated regional delicacies.
See, I have to disagree with you on that one. When I was in high school, that was our thing, man. We'd have we got to leave for high school lunches. We'd have an hour break, and we would go on like Tuesday or whatever day it was, and you could have all you could eat conies, and we would sit there and just see how many cheese conies you could eat without puking.
That leads me naturally to this question. What's your favorite kitchen utensil?
I'd say the steak knife.
A steak knife. You know what's a good one is a spork. Because you get half spoon, half fork. It can take care of most every need you have when
but
it comes to
food. That's not a kitchen utensil. That's like what you get at Taco Bell in your to-go packet.
I don't know where you do your shopping. I'm going to send you a spork for Christmas this year. How about
that? You
have
that? Sporks you know in your drawer?
I do have one myself, but it's mine. I'll send Hawk his own spork. What about this though? I don't play by society's laws. You know, I'm not just going to let it stand still, leave well enough alone. I say that we as a society need to embrace bowls as the primary delivery system for our food. You know, why eat your dinner out off a plate? All right, if it's a steak, you have to cut the steak. But for the most part, aren't we better served using a bowl than a plate?
Yes, that's something that I agree with 100%. I actually think cups should be the number one thing we are served food in. That, I'd say 95% of my meals out of a cup, just because it's so easy. You know, every morning I put a bunch of eggs in my big 20-ounce mm-hmm. cup, of the Gatorade cup we have here, and you can carry it around easier. I mean, the only thing really that you can't eat out of a cup or bowl would, even if a steak, cut your steak up and put it in there in little pieces. That's what I do with my kids.
Wow, that is just tremendous, Hawk. I do the very same thing. I really do. In fact, sometimes, because I'm like Robin Hood for food, sometimes I will take, when they only give it to the people that are on shows and stuff, here's a spread of food. I'll make a cup filled with sausage and I'll give it to everybody else. I'll say, here, it's a cup of sausage, everybody. And they hail
give it to Black Tie, right?
To Black Tie, that's exactly right, who sends his best along. So does the rest of the gang, everybody's excited. Hawk, I think we've talked about this before. Who would play you in a movie?
Denzel Washington.
Denzel. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Outside the box choice. Do you think you're going to heaven?
Yes.
You are. Hey, somebody who is in on the DDFP regularly is Maurice Jones-Drew. He feels like that you guys have some weird acrimony from the field. Are you aware of that? He feels like I brought your name up to him recently and he said, yeah, he and I don't get along. We had a couple of things, when we were playing against one another.
I honestly, now that you bring it up, I didn't think about it until right now. I think years ago when I was playing down in Jacksonville against him, I think he got mad at me I think he thought that I was like using him to get up off the ground. You know, refs will tell you, hey, don't use the ground, don't push up off the running back. And that might have happened at one point. Just, I didn't even mean it. I'm sorry if he feels that way. No hard feelings, Maurice. I have a lot of respect for you, obviously, as a player, but I think he's great on everything he's doing with NFL Network, too. So if he wants to mend the fences or whatever you want to call it, tell him I'm here. My number is open, and I'll answer his call any day, or I'll call him. I'll reach it out to him, man. I love Maurice.
Wow, that's great. Maybe a future guest on the Hawkcast, even.
He'd be awesome. He's a great personality, man.
Hawk, go get him. Keep on rolling. We're happy for you. Stay healthy. And when you're done, all that we need out here in L.A. is you. You're the only missing piece at this point. We're all set to go when you get out here.
I appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me on. You guys are awesome. I watch your stuff, Dameshek. And don't sell yourself short. You were awesome on when you came on my podcast, man. It was great. I got a lot of good feedback from that one.
Hey, there he is, everybody. The great A.J. Hawk. What a pleasure. Yeah. What a pleasure, as always. And really, like I say, that's not jive. I mean, he may just end up stealing the Shecky Award for a third time. Who knows? By the way, programming note, the pie-off 4 is on the way. Claybon, you're officially invited. Handsome Hank, there's been some noise. We do the pie-off here the week of Thanksgiving each and every year. This will be our fourth go-around with this one. Your ticket of admission is your pie. You cannot attend if you don't bring a pie. This year, I guess I'm going to bring a McDonald's apple pie. But ooh, Handsome makes a nice pie. He's always right in the running there. The ladies, Dan Hanzus's ladies, make a pie. They've won 2 straight years. Black Tie always brings some junk to be allowed to attend this thing. Or actually, you didn't bring one last year, Black Tie, did you? And you were kicked out.
No, I didn't bring one because I didn't produce that show, I don't believe.
Well, you weren't allowed to produce the show.
That's right. You weren't allowed to produce the show.
Yeah. It wasn't chicken and egg. This was very much, we know what the chicken
I like
was.
Bringing something different. I had a Jamaican patty once.
Yeah, that was disgusting. Oh.
Yeah, it was grotesque. It was. I'm sure a real one would be good, but you got one at
one from like
7-Eleven.
He got one at the, yeah, wait, he got one, he got one from the gas station and wants to.
You got an authentic, like, Centinela Boulevard?
Yeah.
Yep. And then
Jamaican
he fed
patty?
It. Once more, he fed that to a vegetarian.
Oh, I can't wait. I can't wait. But already, just a little bit of advice for you here before we get to the red challenge flag picks, Claybon. I was talking to Necktie Milner, the first producer of DDFP, by the way, and also a keen competitor last year. He made a bourbon pecan pie that was one of the great pies of all time. Came up a little short last year, but he said, this year I'm thinking about bringing an apple pie. And I reminded him, with all due respect to the McDonald's apple pie, I'm the one and only voter in this competition, right? And apple pie ain't my thing. Go cream pie. Think custard pie. Right. Think coconut cream.
I've got an idea. I don't want to spoil it, but I have an idea. I was initially thinking savory pie.
Savory pie?
I think a meat pie.
You want to go with a shepherd's pie? I'm not going to cry about that. In fact, I'm going to
rejoice.
You're
down for a meat pie but a beef patty? Come on.
Quality of the whatever it is the issue. You brought something from a convenience store.
Patties, bro.
All right, let's get to it. Speaking of spoiling stuff, Get ready, everybody. Your week six is about to be spoiled because before we make our picks, here is the master himself. Football baby, did you see Gary Barnage last week? I covered it in the Shek report. Gary Barnage essentially birthed the football baby.
Yep.
While football baby, the original football baby, felt a little bit like that was, you know, his intellectual property. So he basically showed Gary Barnage and the rest of the world how to do it as he made his week six picks. Take a look.
Football baby, the baby who picks football games.
Colts, Patriots, juice. It is the Patriots.
Lions, Bears, Jews.
Think it through. You are the proud papa of
a bear. Let me see. Confirmations. A bear indeed. Bengals, Bills, Jews. Who would it be? Red Rifle or EJ? It is the Bengals. Seahawks, Panthers, the Jews. You must choose.
Emma?
No, mama.
Nah.
Oh, is it gonna be an upset pick?
Is it gonna be an upset pick? It is the Panthers.
Football, baby.
My creepy voice aside, I feel that is one of the top two
That's
or three most
one.
Delightful. Yeah.
When you talk about upset picks as well, that he was actually upset about making the
pick. The crying for the Bears Lions game, yeah. I understood. Like, yeah. He thought I'm going to make you watch this game. Right. No, yeah, you just have to pick it. Don't exactly. worry. You're not required to look at that one. That would be unfair. That would, in fact, I might be visited by some city officials if I forced my child to watch that terrible game.
Strong knocks on the door.
So there you have it. Football babies picks. And fellas, that means it's time for us to get into it. It is time for the Red Challenge Flag pick segment.
Red Challenge Flag picks. Do, do, do,
do, do. Red Challenge Flag picks. All right, let's start off. Bills, Bengals. There is the history of the recent history of teams coming off of a game against the Seattle Seahawks. Even if the defense isn't as mighty as it has been in the last couple of years, they do still beat you up pretty good. Claybon, again, I'm going to start with you on this one.
I'm taking the Bengals. We don't know if Tyrod's going to play. And whenever you sign Josh Johnson, that's like a sign that says, our quarterback is hurt. We need Josh Johnson. And so he's, you know, got his travel bag. He's in Buffalo this week. And that's why I'm taking the
Claybon, apparently you aren't familiar with the Red Challenge Flag segment. You're supposed to just state your team and then let the would-be challenger offer up his commentary. I'm sorry for that, Handsome.
That's all right.
I'm embarrassed.
I'm
embarrassed for Patrick.
Right, I am too, but let's pretend it didn't.
Yeah, he threw the Red Challenge flag at himself. That's the only way he can salvage any dignity. Handsome, your response.
Dave, it's been a while since I've been able to, I think almost 3 weeks since I've been able to get my Red Challenge flag arm throwing motion going, but I'm going to have to say
that
now.
Geez.
The Bills could be missing their triplets, and I wonder, you know, you talked about triplets during the offseason and maybe revisiting that list at some point during the season would be a fun thing. Tyrod Taylor, Shady McCoy, Sammy Watkins, all three of those guys are questionable for the game, and I don't think that anyone's beating the Bengals without that type of sort of explosive offense.
Well, it would be wrong of me just after I celebrate AJ Hawk's resurgence in Cincinnati, undefeated and everything. It would be wrong for me to pick the Bills. I'm going to pick the Bills. I listen, nobody's going undefeated.
No, EJ Manuel.
Somebody has to lose a game.
Russell Wilson.
Teams lose. That's what happens. The notion that, well, you're crazy to go against this team. Teams lose games.
Yeah, they're going to lose games, but
we're talking about this particular game.
They lose games to better teams. Somewhere down the line, the Bengals are going to lose a game, I have no doubt. Probably will be in January at some point. But I don't for a second believe that this Bills team without those three pieces is going to be the team that beats them.
I think that the Bengals, at some point, these are human beings. At some point, there has to be a letdown. Point. The big rally against the Ravens, then the big rally against the Seahawks. There's going to be a natural letdown. At some point, the Bills have a great defense. And as I mentioned at the top there, the Seahawks, the week after you play the Seahawks, teams have a knack of letting down there physically, and so that's why I'm going to take the Bills there. And by the way, the Bills are a physical team as well, so the double down on playing a really mighty defense like that. Too much for the Red Rifle, I say.
I don't remember you making picks being part of the Red Challenge Flag segment either.
I know, I've added it.
It's all changed. It's all my fault. Right.
It's a fun new wrinkle I added for 2015. All right, let's get to the next game here, the one we've been buzzing about a little bit here. The Panthers at the Seahawks. Handsome Hank, how say you?
Okay, watch how it's done. I think the Seahawks are going to win the game.
The Seahawks. They might be the best. The Seahawks might be the best of all 32 NFL teams for Handsome to say. The Seattle Seahawks.
I think the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Oh, that's not a bad
one. It was fun to hear Hank say as it's fun to hear Hank say anything. Mm-hmm. But my reaction to his actual pick is to adorn him.
Wow, that was a very gentle throw, but nonetheless, I like how bold you are. Is it because Football Baby took the Panthers?
It is mainly because Football Baby took the Panthers, and he's taking the world by storm with how accurate he is with his picks. But it's really a testament to the Panthers have found a way to win games, and the Seahawks have found a way to lose them. And we look back at their last win. If Calvin Johnson is carrying the ball in the other arm, that's another loss.
I also think
winless Lions at home.
If you heard Cam Newton, he doesn't seem to, he's not affected by the mystique of the Panthers. And of the Seahawks in the clink. And I think that's a legitimate concern. Some teams feel before they get there, we have no chance there. But of course, as we've been covering pretty extensively here, it goes way back to a few years ago when Carson Palmer went in there and threw a bunch of picks and they still won. The Packers really had them beat. The Lions just had them beat a couple weeks ago. This is not the same home field advantage it was a couple of years ago. And Cam Newton and those Panthers, I feel like, based on their comments, know that they were right in that game. History has covered up the fact that last January the Seahawks took care of business. But really, if you look back at that game, they were in that one. And I think they feel probably like they let one go there. I think they show up, but I think the Seahawks, they just plainly can't lose this game. I suppose they can suffer a loss and still get to the playoffs. But, getting down to 2-3, 2-4... That's a spot they're not going to want to get into when they're chasing the Cardinals.
They're good, but it would be 2-4 against three teams that would be undefeated at this point.
And there's no shame in it happening, but by schedule and everything else, you don't want to sit at 2-4. And as I always say, the team, unless you're hot garbage in the NFL, the more desperate team tends to win the game. So I'll take the Seahawks for that reason. Arizona Cardinals, Pittsburgh Steelers, Patrick Claybon, how say you?
I've got the Cardinals. Until love.
Handsome. Oh, you almost started it. Analyzing it. Yeah. Good for you.
I also am taking the Cardinals. I think that...
As a Steelers fan, I don't like that.
From what we saw on Monday night, unless Michael Vick has suddenly been given the go-ahead to push the ball downfield, not just by Todd Haley, but in his own mind, that this is something that he can actually do and doesn't need Ben Roethlisberger to call one play a game where he's allowed to. I just don't see how... It's very simple to defend against that Steelers offense. Basically, you're saying we've got to worry about Le'Veon Bell and nothing else.
Well, I hear you in the simplicity of the thought process is we have to take 26 away, but of course that's harder to do. Especially, as you say, if they landed on something late in that game, Pittsburgh, that Mike Vick, let's keep in mind, it's not the short stuff that makes him dangerous. It's getting him out of the pocket and threatening to go up top, or if those safeties come up to try and stop him, or if the safeties do move up to stop number two, he'll throw it over your head, and if you don't, he can still burn you with the legs. All that said, listen, talk about a desperate team or a team that wants it. Bruce Arians wants this game. Remember, the Steelers retired him 3 or 4 years ago. Then two weeks later, he reemerged with the Colts saying I'm not retired at all. That's just what the Steelers want. He then has thrived ever since, maybe is the best coach in the NFL.
Is this the first time he's played against the Steelers since he's left the Steelers?
That's a good question, and I really should know the answer to that one.
But luckily, our producer's listening, and he'll have the answer for us right now.
I'm pretty sure no is the answer to that question.
I'm pretty sure he won't. You're right.
Yeah.
Did he find these
I don't think he's been the head coach. I'm almost positive that the Cardinals
didn't play him. The Colts didn't.
I don't think that they did that that year that Pagano sat down for a few months to take care of his health, and Arians took over. Either way, I'm taking the Cardinals here. I think Mike Vick gets picked off a couple of times by Patrick Peterson and Honey Badger. So, you know, some combo will drop Mike Vick here. But for the record, he and that offense hasn't turned the ball over, and so that's good news.
And that's just because the Chargers were so surprised that he was throwing the ball directly to them, and they didn't actually have to make a play on
it. It's kind of true.
Hitting them in the hands, they're like, "Whoa, whoa!" You realize I'm not on your team.
It's the right move to not rush Roethlisberger to get back out there. Right. Had they lost on Monday night, maybe it's different. But they're 3-2. They can suffer this one. And then they have a big four-game stretch, including the Bengals coming to them, like we talked about with Hawk. Next up, the Chargers at the Packers.
For this one, can you treat us like we're your football babies and ask us to choose?
Oh, I will. Okay. I would like to say this about the Chargers and Packers, you know, because I got a little bit of heat on Twitter for talking about the Steelers side of Monday Night Football. There wasn't a lot to say about the Chargers except two things. One, Melvin Ingram looks like a banger. He's got some fight in him for he reminds me of Chris Johnson except more rugged. Mm-hmm. You know, he is willing to lower the head.
Melvin Gordon.
What did I say? Melvin Ingram. I get confused. Two Melvins
also,
on the same
but also team. Had a good game.
Yeah, he's an intriguing pass rusher, and when he's right, the defense is different. But Phil Rivers, put him in the Hall of Fame. I don't want to continue debate for another 10 years of whether or not he's worthy. He is a Hall of Famer, and the rest of the team is the issue. They're lacking personality, but he's got a ton of it.
The discussion, and let's not get into it now, but the discussion about Phil Rivers being in the Hall of Fame will be protracted, but I agree with you. It shouldn't be a question in the end.
All right. Handsome, there's no reason for this to be protracted. Chargers, Packers, choose.
Thank you for doing that. I say that the Packers will win the game.
Claybon, how say you?
Choose. Packers as well.
Yeah, I got the pack too, and that'll put the Chargers at 2-4 and probably out of the playoff chase. But who knows? You know, who knows? With Phil Rivers, I love that gunslinger in him and that he keeps on going. And that ball was not his fault that got picked, sixth, really, by all rights. The Chargers should have won that game in a lot of places on Monday night. But then again, Pittsburgh should have beaten the Ravens the previous Thursday night. So anyway, all's even there. Here's the one that seems like most people are excited about. I think this isn't going to be a very fun game to watch. But Patriots at the Colts. Claybon, how say you?
The Patriots.
Handsome Hank, how say you?
Yeah, let me throw this somewhere a long way away from Patrick. This one is not just going to be like who's going to win. I think the Patriots are going to hang 50 points on the Colts, and I think they're going to embarrass them. And I think everyone in that organization, because of Deflategate, because the Colts were being talked about as the AFC representative for this year in the Super Bowl for months after the Patriots had won the Super Bowl, and I'm sure Bill Belichick can find a way to make it feel like he's been disrespected about that. I think the Patriots have every motivation to not just beat the Colts, but to really beat the Colts.
Well, motivation and all that, and all 100% valid, but also it's a perfect storm in terms of matchup. Nate Solder's out for the Patriots at left tackle, but no matter. Who are they playing? They're playing one of the worst defenses in the NFL. Vontae Davis is legitimate, but that's that's a very Belichick Brady kind of thing to solve, is that, you know, whereas other teams are obstinate about that, they'll just not go at Vontae Davis, or they'll figure a way to isolate that
Ike took us through his top five corners earlier in the week, and he wasn't one of those top five guys, and I still don't think he's a guy that you just don't throw the ball at.
I suppose, but either way, you say 50, I'm not jiving on this. I think 60.
60?
I think they are going to, not that they don't always try to score every time. We know that from Belichick and Brady, that they're always trying to do that. We remember what's their all-time best? 63
they hung on the Titans a couple of years ago.
They
were wearing the old uniforms.
It was in the snow.
It was in the snow in October. It suddenly snowed in like mid-October, and they were like, okay, let's just wipe.
There
this
will
team
be
off
no snow to hide under if you're the Colts. The game's in Indianapolis after all. I'm telling you, I think they are going to do their best to humiliate the Colts as thoroughly as they possibly can. And I don't know if they're better off with Luck or Hasselbeck, but it really doesn't make a difference this week. I think the Colts are gonna get housed. If it's within four touchdowns, my jaw will be on the floor.
Well, the only thing that may keep them from getting 60 is if Luck is really having difficulty pushing the ball, and so it's all checkdowns, all short stuff, and they run the clock enough to keep them to 40.
That would be my strategy if I were the Colts. So let's just keep running it and just spin the clock as much as we possibly can. Next up, Giants at the Eagles. Now, this one is intriguing stuff in the NFC East. No one's out of that division because no one is great so far. Who picked the last one here? Handsome, you're up. Giants at Eagles. How say you?
I have picked the Giants to win this one.
Claybon, how say you? Listen, remember, I like some drama here. Listen, conflict is the heart of drama.
All right, well, then
you got one.
Then here, let me.
But if you're going to throw it. You don't toss it at them.
Well, these, okay.
Yeah,
how's
there
that?
You go.
How's
that's
that?
A throw. That's a throw.
I will switch my pick, and I will take. I'll take the Eagles.
Peer pressure.
Because just
got
no, it's not just peer pressure. It's looking at this division and what it will take to win it. And you see the way that Dallas is floundering. They've got Matt Castle is coming in as a savior, and Brandon Wheaton hasn't won a game starting at quarterback in his last 11 tries, which is something Troy Aikman did also, but. We're talking about Whedon here.
It's very interesting that we're focusing on Castle and Whedon. They will have no hand in this game.
Well, the hand that they do have is hope. Looking at what Dallas is going through gives the Eagles hope.
I see.
From where they came
yes.
from.
Yep, that's right.
Just a couple of weeks ago, that there is hope.
They'd be out of it if they were in the NFC right. South, as right. for instance. Right.
Yeah,
but
absolutely.
As it is, they're right here.
And the Giants lost those games with some clock management, and they have gotten better. And that's why I initially was leaning that way. But thinking about it more, the Eagles have.
Well, yeah, I mean, consider no Prince Amukamara. That's bad. That's a bad place to start now. He's down for a while. Mm-hmm. And they don't have. They may not have Beckham. They definitely don't have Cruz. I mean, listen, the people just go with uniforms too much. Like, well, they've been good. But yeah, but they're missing now pieces that help them win games.
The Giants are one uniform you don't want to go with because they haven't ever been, you know, even throughout the Tom Coughlin era when they've been winning Super Bowls, they've not been a particularly consistent team. And a Giants team that will have an incredible comeback like they did last Sunday doesn't necessarily translate to the next week that Giants team showing up again.
I'm going against what some smart guys who played the game have told me this week. They said, you watch, this Chip Kelly thing is going down. Just because they pulled it out in the second half last week does not mean that that's going to continue mm-hmm. a roll. I'm going against those thoughts and saying that, in fact, by sticking with Sam Bradford after two straight picks thrown into the end zone, the fact that Chip Kelly stuck with him turns the corner for Bradford, turns the corner for the locker room, that they now see Chip Kelly has the starters back like that. I think that matters. And by the way, I keep saying it, but the Eagles defense is sneaky good. I say Eagles take that one.
What if the locker room is thinking that he should move on from Sam Bradford?
I don't, I get no sense. I mean, valid question. And I think the fact that I'm sure half the guys on the sideline, at least when he threw that second interception, probably thought to themselves, well, that's the end of Bradford. Now we're going to go to Sanchez here. The fact that he didn't and it worked out imbues the locker room with some confidence in the head man's decision making.
I wonder if though the locker room who've seen Sanchez play on that team, it would be different if it was a backup quarterback that hadn't proven it and hadn't done it for them. And look, I don't think Mark Sanchez is a top quarterback, but
he's not. I agree with you about that.
That team has seen him, or most of the guys on there, because a lot of them didn't play for the Eagles last year, but they've seen him do it in that offense. So I would suspect that some of them would say, but wait, why would we stick with this guy when we know that Sanchez has at least had an opportunity and has proven himself in this offense?
Well, my answer to that is that you saw Sanchez do it in places, but when he got against a good defense, he fell apart.
You've seen the ceiling of Mark Sanchez. Right. You don't know how good Sam Bradford
I think
be
we
in
do.
This offense.
Real quick, let's take a look at my picks for week six. And you see, I took the Browns at home against the Broncos. I like that Browns defense. It's not a cakewalk. You can run on it, but I do think that's a good defensive battle there. Couple real bad games. Dolphins at Titans. I'm sorry, Handsome. That counts as a bad game
days. I wouldn't disagree.
Ravens at 49ers. A sad rematch of a great Super Bowl from a few years ago. And by the way, one of the most underrated Super Bowls in history. Yeah. People don't count that one in their top like four or five. Go back and look at that one. Yep. That's a dandy. It's got everything, including the weirdo blackout and everything else.
Yep.
As we look back, I invoke the past. So let's wrap it up here. With our thanks to AJ Hawk and to you guys and everything. But I do want to show you this. Remember, we talk about the clink and how devastating a matchup it can be to have to travel up there. Even before they got the newfangled uniforms, they had the old newfangled uniforms. You remember the beast mode run?
Oh, how can
the
you?
The famous one against the Saints. The 7-9 Saints. Oh, no, the 7-9 Seahawks hosting the New Orleans Saints there. Everybody remembers that, and you've seen it a million times, of course, but you've never heard it from the New Orleans Saints broadcast team. You know, it's a great play if you're a Seahawks fan. Not so great if you were a Saints fan or a Saints broadcaster. It's time for the latest installment of the worst plays in NFL history.
Feel like we should be here in the first place, but to get the stop here, Saints get the ball back, you're going to feel good. It's a handout to Lynch, and Chandler have him. Okay, break that tackle. Now he's going to run through Sharp and Adair. Here come Porter. Oh, goodness, he done nose wide open, faded Porter there, and Lynch going to skip into the end zone, dive in for the touchdown, and that going to make it awful tough on these Saints there as Breeze take the hat off, put the helmet on, think about getting back to Burke. I don't know what he have in his left shoe. Must have been a chicken foot and a turkey neck in the right. Marshawn Lynch gets a hug from Pete Carroll. I remember embracing a young lady like that on Bourbon Street. 3 minutes left, down by 11. Ain't looking good. Here we go, look at the replay. And Lynch take the handoff from Hasselbeck. And oh, Chandler get Kuya on there. And it becomes a crab boil in a hurry. Look at Greer. What a f***ing motherfucker not make that tackle there. And now Lynch gonna treat Porter like some kind of kid treat a lightning bug when it scrape him on the street to see it glow. I have not felt a building shake like this since the biggest set of I done saw in the French Quarter 3 years ago. And I believe he done grabbed his there too. Much as I hate to say it, you can't beat that with a stick.
I don't know what it is. Maybe it makes me a bad person that I kind of revel in other people's pain, but I just love those. I love seeing it. It's a neat look into something.
It takes you into the feeling.
Yeah, it reminds you, you know what? There's a loser in every victory. You know, somebody is feeling some pain out there. Anyway, so that's the end of the show.
Dave, talking about losers, just very quickly, you and Black Tie both asked me to bring something back for you.
Oh, right, yes.
And talking about losing things, so I just want to explain why I haven't yet given you, delivered the gifts to you both that I did. I wanted to bring something different. We've done chips or crisps from the UK, we've done candy, all that stuff. And I know you love pies. I was bringing you a pork pie. Pork pie, I don't know if you've ever had a pork pie from the UK, but it's some kind of congealed pork wrapped around with gelatin and then with a delicious pastry over the top. I mean, it's a sensational snack for lunch. You get about that big. It's like eating a big pork cake, right? Like a pork cupcake.
Pork cake.
Pork cake.
And it's pork cake, exactly. So, I mean, that sounds pretty good, right? I get to customs, and a man on this side of the of my flight tells me that you're not allowed to bring pork cupcakes into the United States and confiscated it from me.
What?
And I said, I was telling him, like, you know, this is a pork, you're not allowed to bring meat products. And I almost got kicked straight back out of the USA. and this was for you. But I was like, please just tell me, I get it, I'm not allowed to bring it, I don't want to break any rules, but please tell me you're going to eat it. And so he asked me to describe what it was, and I described it in exactly the same way that I did just to you. And he threw it in the trash.
What?
Oh. I couldn't believe it.
That is an outrage. Right. I want this officer's name.
I nearly took his name down, but then I realized I should probably just...
What? He's a U.S. Customs guy?
Did he look you in the eye as he threw it?
He looked me in the eye, and I said, look, it's pork, and then you've got this gelatin around it, and he said, I don't want that. And threw it in there.
I love the voice you gave.
I get the picture now with a voice. Yeah, makes sense.
He wasn't playing around. He didn't want it. And Black Tie, I said to you, I'd bring you some Maltesers, and I bought you some Maltesers, and I got them through customs, and I took at the moment I ate them all.
Oh, that's personal.
Yes. That makes me happy.
Personal. Oh man.
Hey, you know what we did get, Black Tie? Oh, we just got a care package from the UK, didn't we? From from Scotland, I believe.
Scotland, that's right.
Let's crack that one on the next episode and see what's in there. Maybe there will be some nice vittles in there from the UK still.
I don't know how McDonald's feels about that, but we'll see.
feels about what? We're allowed to eat food,
aren't
we?
Open up some new snacks? I don't
know. Yeah, we'll eat some nice snacks. I can't believe that custom sink. Yeah. What you needed to do was, see, when he took that meat pie, what he did was, oh, by the way, let me just say, again, thank you to the great A.J. Hawk, and, oh, a little sneak preview, spoiler alert for you, that's not all with A.J. Hawk. We have another bit that we shot with him earlier that we will have for you next week, so be on the lookout for that one. In the meantime, Patrick Claybon, Handsome Hank, great stuff from you guys, from everybody behind the glass. Thanks for listening, thanks for watching, and don't forget to watch on Sunday, NFL Now Game Day Blitz. But back to what I was saying, what you needed to do was, you needed to take that pork pie and say, hey, customs officer, here's what I would do with it.
Find out more on the next DDFP.